Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today we start a new section in where I will be speaking about some projects. I'm not doing only LLMs, and I'm also working in other types of projects in machine learning. And in this section, I will go through some of the technologies I've been using in the past and how I solved some of the use cases I had to face in the past, and how I did it, and how we approach the solution of all those problems. Then one of the technologies I've been working in for the past years has been computer vision, OCR, object character recognition, and this is a very old use case. There is mature technology that you can mature libraries, applications, and then there is something that the world probably is not very interesting for many people, but I think that we can cover a number of videos and review what is the state of the art of the technologies available and solutions available, not only offline or to work in at home or in a on-premise location, also the cloud solutions that we had available in practically all the main cloud providers had their own service, and they are working all of them pretty well. But in any case, I thought that it will be interesting for you to know how you can work with this. I will give you, as well as usual, some examples how I did it, and I hope that you like it. So let's start. And then the first technology, obviously, I'm going to look at is Tesseract. Tesseract is an old technology. It's there for many years. It's coming from a software developed in the past by Hewlett Packard. Back in the, well, you have here a brief history. I will give you, well, you had already all these links on the notebooks. Later on, I will share with you on the YouTube channel. And well, again, this very old use case is something that is there for many years. It's a quite mature technology, and originally developed in C++. Then on, it had been this with multiple languages. One of them is Python, obviously. In Python, was working for a long time Google on that, and also create this is the seed of the service that Google already had available on Google Cloud, no? But we will move to this in another tutorial, in another person. Today we will see only offline or on-premise solutions. That is what I initially implemented. No? Again, you can install this in Windows, in Linux. There is multiple configurations, Docker configurations, which are just ready to download from Docker Hub and run. And well, I simply took one of them and personalized it for the use case I've been working on. And I will show you in few seconds how I did it. Tesseract depends heavily on Lectonica. Lectonica is another library, open source library, which is was created as well long time ago for image processing and image analysis. The same that Tesseract, they are free to use, open source. That you can, I think the Tesseract is coming with Apache license, Apache 2, and Lectonica is a derivation of Yeah, they had a, it's worth it to take a look just to understand the kind of compromise you have when you use this the software, no? But in any case, free to use, open source, no? Okay. So in my case, at the time that we had to choose a solution, I was looking and comparing, especially in the last project when I had to create a solution, end-to-end solution, Dockerize with the entry points, which essentially just send a document, which any document, and detect it had images, and it had images with text extracted text, regardless the file type, regardless the how the image is coming and detecting quality, etc., etc. And then we look at the different solutions, online and not online, and then finally we had to, or I had to take one of the solutions offline. Tesserar is one of them, but we look at a second one that was Paddle OCR, which claims to be a state, and it's true, it's a state of the art as well solution, but and also be that it was able to work with a GPU, so speed up the processing with a GPU, so moving part of the processing, especially the processing that the library is doing on with the neural network to the GPU. Finally, we didn't take that solution, Paddle OCR, because at the end, well, this in this kind of pipelines, moving the data to the GPU means to refactor to create kind of additional logic to do kind of multiprocessing, because these libraries are ready to work sequentially, so page by page, and then there is no real advantage in moving the data to the GPU. And then Tesserar is not well, there is some scripts developed by third parties, not tested, at the that also do something similar to what the Paddle OCR is doing, but again, in this kind of pipelines, or at least for this solution that I made, we found that moving the data to the GPU is not appropriate, and you don't get any real advantage doing that, no? And then it's not, this is not training a neural network where you move the batch, or you move the data set to the memory, you move the model, and everything is working on the GPU. Here you need to read a file. From the file, it is an image, is coming one by one, GPGs, images. If you have images into a document like a doc, like a PDF, like a PowerPoint, you need to extract the images, and then you need to process it one by one, and then on again, you can make a kind of logic to do multiprocessing, but yeah, we found that there is an additional complexity that is not worth it to be implemented, and then on that was not real advantage to introduce the complexity of moving the data to the GPU, and there is other alternatives that I will show you right away, better than moving the data to the GPU. And then if you have to compete in quality and in number of languages supported, well, there is no comparison in my case in between Tesserar and Paddle OCR. While again, it's a very good technology, this promising, is developed in China. I give you as well the link, and it's working pretty well. There is multiple applications that you can do, and yeah, I say I have nothing again but to say for this technology, as it's working. But again, in my case, we decide to continue with Tesserar. Tesserar I think here you can go, is some of the blah blah blah. I think some of this here in the documentation is speaking about the number exactly here. Tesseract recognize more than 100 different languages. In my case, for now, I'm not working with Chinese or Arabic or Russian. So all that for now, we had to recognize it's Latin derivative languages. So it's working fine. Also, not handwriting. For handwriting, we will look at this in another tutorial, in another video. But well, for the use case we have, is working pretty well. We are recognizing in the project or working with mainly with four different languages: English, French, German, and Spanish. And we don't need even to personalize the language. It's true that, for example, with Spanish, you don't recognize the ñ. But well, the majority of the or other languages, like in German, some of the punctuation characters are not correctly recognized. But it's a process as well that we will be fine-tuning later on. Most of the characters are correctly recognized, 99% of them, just simply using the gene in English by default, no? And then on, you have a number of models that come predefined. You can download locally, and then again, all these model languages are based in LSTN's neural networks. Well, and then again, they are working very efficiently and very accurate without any further configuration. While in any case, you have multiple parameters that you can personalize for your application, like the space or in between characters, language, as I said, and many others. No, that you can go through the information. And yeah, as I said, only with the default configuration we managed to make it work, and we are well, and the client is also very satisfied with the output of Tesseract, and well, for the time being is being fine. No? Additionally, to speed up the process, what we found that it was good for us, it was to use a wrapper that was developed by Dan Bloomberg. They are using directly Python bindings with the C++ library, using another library that is CFFI. And where we found that this is working quite more fast than the library, that the pure Python library, PyTesseract, which again was developed by Google, and then it is finally the solution that we implemented. I will show you now how it works. If you had interest to see how it works Padel OCR, just let me know, and I will be creating, we'll share some of the tests we do with the Padel OCR, even how to move, how to work with the GPU. It's based in PyTorch, so it's very good software as well, and you can maybe also take a look for your specific your case. No, again, in our case, we found that this solution is good enough, and then we will be working on improving the software of the solution once we had an additional requirement, especially to introduce other languages like Indian or Hindu or Chinese and or Russian. which requires specific configurations, because yeah, these characters come with very different, especially for example Arabic, which you read from right to left. All the softwares initially already to read the document from left to right and from top down. So this every language in those languages are specific, very specific, and once we had to work with them, we need to do a specific configuration to Tesseract or to any other, just to make them work correctly. Okay, so well, I give you here some of the links to you review it your when after the video you had the interest, and also I give you some alternatives. We tested all of them as well, not only for this last project, for other projects before, OCR Space, all of them are cloud solutions, Microsoft Azure, this computer vision with had OCR functionalities, Amazon as well, Tesseract and Google Cloud, which have as well computer vision OCR service, which all of them, again, I tested, I worked with them, well, and they had very, very good outcome, and they are working fast. They give you a lot of metadata to later on build anything that you need, you may need, not only the extraction, also bonding boxes. There is possibility, for example, in Azure they are giving also the angle or rotation case that you send a document with this rotated, no, not landscape mode. Is when a document is rotated, kind of some degrees to the right or to the left, not correctly scan it, or somebody could take a screenshot with the telephone, because obviously you can find any of these documents in a data lake. People send the information not many times, not after scanning in a scanner, in a printer scanner or a multifunction printer scanner. It's just taking a screenshot with the telephone or a picture with the telephone, and then you have to work it out how to extract the data from there. So many cases of that, where the quality is key. Also again, the rotation is fundamental. You need to apply some techniques to read the data from those documents, and well, it's quite easy to do this. You don't need to create logic in your code, as we had to do in the services. They do it everything for you, and they had very good quality. In my case, again, I need to use an offline solution, because many the applications or the products work offline, many times without connection to internet, and then we cannot use cloud solutions for that case. Another problem, there is three main problems with scanning, at least of my experience. One is again the quality in images is key. Secondly, the rotation, which is difficult, create a lot of difficulties at the time to extract the text from the document. And secondly, and finally, well, practically all of them of the solutions I try, they had a lot of issues at the time that you had two columns. In the text, at the style of the research papers, for example, where you have you read the document first of all the left column, and second and later on you go reading the left column from top to down, and then on you move to the right column and start again from top to down. These kind of documents are really problematic when you need to extract the data using OCR, and then most of the solutions most of the solution had a lot of issues with these documents. even not telling you when these documents that come from translations that into legal documents, for example, which have for example, a contract in English in the left and the translation to German in the right, and it's again two columns and even into different languages, which is complicating even more the extraction of the text. But we had there is solutions for all these problems, some of them are more satisfactory than others, and then we can go through all of them one by one in different videos. Today we will just go to the basics, how to use Tesseract, which is really simple. And install the software is pretty straightforward, case that you do it in Windows or Linux. Finally, you need to download the binary, put it on the pad, download the models, and that's it. If you don't download, when you download the binary, you download the model as well. By default, it's going to use the English language, and then, as I said before, we found it that is good enough for most of the Latin derivative languages, with some small issues with some of the character of the punctuation characters, but for the rest it's working pretty well. And again, you can go to the documentation to do the installation. I will not cover it because again it's very simple. Also, the install the library is very simple. It's pip and that's it. And then it's not even worth it to cover this. To follow the process. How I did it in my implementation on this notebook, you will need as well the CFFI library, which as well is pretty simple to install PIP dashes, and then we will not cover as well. But essentially, CFFI is just a Python library which allows you to load a DLL in C or C++, and then on work. So the code is working. In my case, is a DLL, is a C++ class which we load, and then all this library is interacting with the Tesseract software. We found that is working more faster than the pure the Python library, the pure Python library. Even the cost of communicating Python with C++, it has a cost obviously, but it's working faster than the Python library itself, the PyTesseract. So I will cover first of all, I will explain you a little bit how we did it. When we import the libraries we need, we just create here a method to find the DLL, which obviously changes if you are in Windows or if you are in a 32 or 64 bit system. We open create a FFI object. You see the object is just the code in C to interact with Tesseract. We will not cover this. Somebody had interest, I can do something apart to cover this code, but essentially it's just interacting with the binary. Doesn't matter if the binary is in Unix or the binary is in Windows, the class is exactly the same, and you can work with both operating systems without changing a single comma of this software. This method is to work with Lectonica, just to get you the resolution of the image. Also very important, in some cases you need to, depending on the image, the file type, Lectonica will create an object will give you the resolution. The object extracted with Electonica will have some attributes or others depending on the format of the images that you are reading. It's not the same to read a GIF, that to read a BMP, that to read a TIFF, that to read a GPG, etc. So, well, the code that we had is adapted to that. We will cover this in a separate video as well, how we extract data, extract text from different formats, not only from images, which is the simple case, also from documents, PDFs, and docs, ODF, and PowerPoint, and others. No? And then depending of the source, where you have, which type of image you had, also require additional configurations, because the objects created by Electonica are slightly different. And then we need to get the resolution from different attributes that from the different attributes that the Electonica library are creating in some dictionaries that create after reading the image. Here we just simply find the path where we had the DLL, and we load the Tesseract and Electonica. Also we find the path of the models. It's pretty simple. There is, you need this variable, environmental variable, to be initialized where you have the models. It's not you will get an error. And here we just open the libraries with the CFFI library. We get the versions. We are using one of the latest versions of Tesseract and also Electonica. Again, you have the Dockers with this installed, just ready to go. You don't need to do practically anything. Just pull the Docker and start to work with. We didn't do it that way. We just personalize to our convenience, because at the end this application is working in our Docker behind an entry point developed with the FAST API, and then we integrate this component is also part of a bigger pipeline where we scan multiple types of documents, and this, when we had images, the images come to this component and they are analyzed, the component extracted this and send the text back for further processing to the pipeline. Here I just give you an example. This is a Tesseract, let me check, it's just a document data. I don't know what I have it here. Yeah, it's probably one of these. It's just a curriculum, a CV from somebody, I don't know even who, but yeah, it's we take a software, we take an image, we do several tests, here is GPG, but we transform as well to PNG, to other formats, just to do the test. And then here, just again, today is the initial and simply test how this works. We open the image with Pillow, we get the resolution with Electonica, and then on this image is 72x72 DPI, and then on we create the object Tesseract, and then finally we just simply extract the test, and here we just preparing the environment from Tesseract, and here extracting the text with this method. No? Finally, we are just calling one of the native methods of Tesseract and transforming the output to text. As you see here, this is the output. Some small problems, yeah, this with the bullet points, but well, again, in the final version we don't have this issue. We need to set up some small parameters in the library to the library be able to recognize this correctly, these bullet points. No? because here each you can see sometimes it recognize the bullet point as a E, but well, later also you can do this with the regex or with the kind of pattern recognition that some of these you will filter it and not even how to say have this problem. You don't need even to parameterize TSRR, just you just can remove it. If you see that this is a general pattern happening on the software, no? The time that it took 11,000 microseconds, which is really good. I make here some calculations, but well, you can make yours in your scenario. This is working local in the pipeline, is working even fast. And here we just simply create some bounding boxes to show how the software is working and how it recognizes the text, and just we plot it. And as you can see here how the software is reading the image. It's just going left to right, top down, and then you can see here the accuracy, that the confidence that the every that the software had in that the words that is providing to you has, no? So you can see here, this is again just as an example, and then you see here the confidence is very low. So we can, you can work out this as well and see, well, everything that is below some threshold you can remove it, or well, there is plenty of the possibilities once you have this data. But in general, as you see, it's working extremely well. So it this space is also a parameter, the space that you have in between words, something that you can parameterize. And again, here with the modeling language by default, is working really well. Here I make another example with a PDF. This is a simple PDF is something simple scanner. You can see here Thanogron is that one. Yeah, it's simply text. And again, as I told you, this is just part of another pipeline. We just use this. This is a PDF. You probably know as well that there is essentially two kinds of PDFs. One is this, the usual, the conventional PDF that is generated by a PDF library, which is containing the text and the metadata, which but is a semi-structured file which you can extract with a conventional library. You don't need to apply computer vision for that. And the other PDFs are images. It's also a PDF containers, but the structure, internal structure, is quite different. I think I can give you an example. If you just take this PDF and open it with Notepad, you will see that here. So you see that there is multiple binary data, and then you can do a simple test to check if there is this is an scanner file or this is a file produced with a library. You just try to find font, and if you don't find it, if you don't find font, the document. Before you just need to find a font in this format. If you don't find it, the text is essentially an image. If you find font, you may have text and images together, but most likely the document, the PDF, is generated with a PDF library and is not scanned. If you don't find font, as you see on the image, you can be sure that the document is scanned. And then on okay, the document, again, we just extract the documents from So the text from the document, and then we move this text to another component with Strat, PIR, and GDPR entities with an NLP library. The process is quite similar. The code, the Tesseract code logic don't change at all. It's just here we need a library to open the PDF and extract page by page. This is an additional challenge in comparison with simple images. Here you just need to, obviously, in a document, a Word document, a PDF, a PowerPoint, you can have multiple images inserted on the documents, and you have to extract data from all of them. No? You have to extract the text from all of them, all the pages. Here, just we create a loop, and this loop covers open with this library. In this case, we use PDF to image. Is one of the libraries, just converting every page, is reading the document page by page and extracting the images and serializing the image to a temporal file. And then on here, we just simply take the page, we convert it to an array, a NumPy array, and the NumPy array we read it with pillow, and then on from then the process starts. Exactly the same that you have an image here. Already we had here in this, after this conversion, we had an image. Again, it can be an image which covers the whole page or simply a part of the page. But well, we just with this logic, we just extract the images from the PDF. We do something similar for other documents, and then once you have here the image, we have it in an NumPy array, and then once you have here, the process is exactly the same than opening a conventional image, a JPG or a TIFF. The software here, again, we get a slightly better outcome, and you see here the output, and that's it for now. It's pretty simple to use. In a second tutorial, we will cover how we extract data from other kind of documents files, that's all for today. But the process in general is not going to change too much. It's pretty simple. What you had is try to find the images. Every document had their own structure internally, and then you just find the image, you extract it to a temporal file, and then you handle it with the Tesseract library. Because you are extracting the image and converting to a file with a specific format, and the software is going to work exactly the same regardless the type of documents. The only thing that you need to consider is how to later on you join the extracted text in a single document. And that's it. Thank you very much for watching. If you like it, just hit me a like and subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before. Thank you very much. Bye bye.